Good morning, everybody. We are so glad you guys are here. Welcome back. If you are a newcomer, we're so happy that you're here with us. We'd love it if you would take the back of your bulletin, which I don't currently have one to show you, but there's a perforated sheet on the back. That's the connection card. You can fill that out and drop it in our little black box over here, or you can scan the QR code that's on there and fill out the online version if you'd prefer to do that. We would just love to reach out to you and thank you for being here. And special good morning, good evening, good whatever time of day it is to anyone watching online, whether you're watching Facebook Live now, good morning. And if you're watching on YouTube later, we're just happy you're spending time with your day with us. Why don't we stand up together and we'll pray before we begin our service. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for this first Sunday of Advent. Lord, we just pray that as we enter in this season, that we would truly understand what it means for you to come and be born and be fully human and fully God at the same time with us, Father. We love you. We pray that you would be in this service with us and we would feel your presence. In your name we pray. Amen. Continue to lift up his name.
Lay down his sleep. stars in the sky look down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay.
Your name forever. We'll raise your name.
Well, you guys, don't be seated yet. We have a quick announcement. We have these wonderful little packets of paper. This is an Advent paper chain, and we're going to do this one per family. There are lots of instructions here, and it's just a really great way that we can celebrate Advent as a family. You guys can get these out here in the foyer, and I'm going to be honest, I have not looked at this as much as I should. I can't wait to do it with Owen. So make sure you grab your Advent paper chain out here after service today, and now we're going to dismiss kids to the back of the room to meet your teachers, and we are going to take 2 minutes to greet each other, our first Advent greeting of the year. So 2 minutes starts a very joyous right now.
Good morning, everyone. I'm really glad to see you here today. Now we will read a Bible. Could you stand up, please? And Psalm 80, 2b-3. Stir up your might and come to save us. Restore us, O God. Let your face shine, that we may be saved. Heavenly Father, teach us what truly matters to you. You called us when others didn't. Thank you for offering us salvation and love, and forgive us of the pride that keeps us from you. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. The Merriam-Webster Dictionary comes up with a word of the year each year. The idea of a word of the year is that it's a word that's looked up frequently, but it also has to capture something about culture in a given year. Now, before I tell you what the actual word is, let me tell you what the runners up are. If you know what this word means, maybe raise your hand. Riz. Okay, three of you. Okay, a deep fake. Okay, coronation. Okay, yes. And the word that was ultimately chosen as the 2023 word of the year is authentic. Now, authentic, I think that's a word that a lot of us know. But the interesting thing is that authentic has a variety of meanings. It means not false. It means, you know, not an imitation. It also means real and actual. But there's a newer meaning that ties to this idea of being true to one's own personality, spirit, or character. And so while being authentic is obviously a desirable thing, what exactly it means is something that people do wonder about, something that people do debate, and so it leads them to look it up. Okay, 2022 word of the year was gaslighting. If you're not familiar, let me catch everybody up. Gaslighting is the act or practice of grossly misleading someone, especially for one's own advantage. The term gaslighting comes from the title of a 1938 play and became a movie, and it involves a man attempting to make his wife believe that she is going insane. He has these mysterious activities that he is doing in the attic, and it causes the house's gas lights to dim. And he insists to his wife that the lights are not dimming, and she cannot trust her own perceptions. This idea of a deliberate conspiracy to mislead has made gaslighting a very helpful term to describe lies that are part of a larger plan, whether it's something we're experiencing in a relationship or something that we think may be happening on a grander scale. Well, neither of these words sound very Christmassy, but they actually tie to where we're headed today as we begin Advent, the four Sundays leading up to Christmas. This Christmas season, this Advent season, we will be looking at the words light, love, joy, and peace, and each week consider a psalm that ties to these words. Now, light, love, joy, and peace are very happy words, right? This could be in a Hallmark commercial, this graphic right here, because commercials lead us to believe that everything should be merry and bright at this time of year. And if you're not, maybe there's something wrong with you. Maybe there's a bit of a Grinch in you, that you're missing that Christmas spirit. But honestly, this feel-good idea isn't one that's just pushed on us culturally at Christmas. It's all over American culture. Our culture really struggles to make space for feelings that could be described as negative. We see it even in employment policies. There's this thing called bereavement leave when someone dies. Now, if you are fortunate enough to work for a company that offers this, it's often very short. It's often for just very particular people in your life. And we're pushed and encouraged to rush past any sort of negative emotion, anger, fear, sadness, grief. So here we are on the first Sunday of Advent, and we're going to talk about light because our church, our world, maybe our homes are filled with warm spices and twinkly lights. The anticipation of the season is high. And then we open Psalm 80, where we're going to be today. And it's going to slap us all in the face. Merry Christmas. It's a psalm of lament. But we're going to do this today because we don't want to just rush in to the jolly of the season. As we look at the scriptural story of Christmas, it's a rough beginning. It's a beginning of 400 years of people watching and waiting and lamenting that the promised Messiah has not yet come. And so I want us to take time today to celebrate the light of Christmas, but also with looking at lament. Psalm 80 is a lament that is filled with grief, anger, sadness, despair. And those feelings are directed toward God. Now, darkness and light, lament and hope, they're more related than sometimes we like to think. But we can't really appreciate one without acknowledging the other. So let's read this lament together. Psalm 80. Hear us, shepherd of Israel, you who lead Joseph like a flock, you who sit enthroned between the cherubim, shine forth before Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh. Awaken your might, come and save us. Restore us, O God, make your face shine on us that we may be saved. How long, Lord God Almighty, will your anger smolder against the prayers of your people? You have fed them with the bread of tears. You have made them drink tears by the bowlful. You have made us an object of derision to our neighbors, and our enemies mock us. Restore us, God Almighty. Make your face shine on us that we may be saved. You transplanted a vine from Egypt. You drove out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it. And it took root and it filled the land. The mountains were covered with its shade, the mighty cedars with its branches. Its branches reached as far as the sea, its shoots as far as the river. Why have you broken down its walls so that all who pass by pick its grapes? Boars from the forest ravage it, and insects from the fields feed on it. Return to us, God Almighty. Look down from heaven and see. Watch over this vine, the root your right hand has planted, the sun you have raised up for yourself. Your vine is cut down. It is burned with fire. At your rebuke, your people perish. Let your hand rest on the man at your right hand, the son of man you have raised up for yourself. Then we will not turn away from you. Revive us, and we will call on your name. Restore us, Lord God Almighty. Make your face shine on us that we may be saved. Psalm 80 is this lament that's directed at God. The people in this lament are blaming God for a terrible situation. In verse 5, they say God has fed them tears. In verse 6, they feel that their neighbors are mocking them. In verse 12, they're pointing out that the walls that used to protect them have been knocked down. The people see God as the one who's behind all things, both good and bad. But often, people are living with the consequences of their own actions. So even so, they direct their anger at God. Sometimes we do this too, right? We blame God for things that aren't God's fault. Now, in this psalm, even though people blame God for their situation, they still affirm and believe that God is trustworthy, loving, and good. And they call out to God to restore them with the expectation that God will hear them and will respond. So the first thing to know this morning is that faithful people can lament to God. Faithful people can lament to God. The people behind Psalm 80 feel free to call out to God, even be angry toward God, but they do this in the midst of faith. The words here are the words of someone who has confidence in a God who has proven goodness again and again. We see that past faithfulness reflected in verses 8 through 11. They plead for that goodness to happen again, demonstrating trust that if God cared for them then, God will care for them now as well. The lament is rooted in hope. They're taking the time to address God with it because they believe that God will listen and respond. Now, this is not the only culture in these ancient days that wrote laments. Other cultures wrote laments as well. But there was a difference between Hebrew lament and the lament of other Near Eastern societies. The other folks of the other religions, they would lament in order to try to gain the attention of the gods. So they would call out to try to get attention. But biblical lament was different. It was a function of worship toward the hope of rescue. It wasn't just a woe is me, the gods hate me, have abandoned me, I have to wave my hands and scream to get attention. No, these were saying, God, Yahweh, we believe that you're still there. We believe that you are still at work. We believe that there is still hope. And we can do the same things. We can cry out to God and name the hardness. And that is not a lack of faith. That's not saying, God, you abandoned me. You've left me to the wolves. It's saying, God, I believe that you will show up again. We don't preach a whole lot on lament. I try to do a couple of per year because it's so often neglected. But if I were to take all the sermons I've ever heard in my life, there wouldn't be that many. But the interesting thing is that there are more psalms of lament than there are any other types of psalm. Then we take the fact that there's an entire book of the Bible devoted to lament, Lamentations. So we know that it matters to God that we take time to name the hard truths of living in a broken world. To lament is part of what it means to follow God. And neglecting lament is problematic. It can project onto God the false reality that God doesn't care about our truthful emotions or experiences, or that we have to present ourselves a certain way to come before God, or we have to have it together to show up to church. Those are lies. It also helps us when we lament, it helps us to push away prosperity gospel, the idea that if your faith is big enough, if you've really, really cast off all secret sin, that you are going to be rich and housed and happy and healthy and in love. And if you don't have those things, really something is wrong. That is a lie. That is not biblical. That is not biblical. But when we neglect to lament, somehow we start to think that you're only living a faithful life if you have all the shiny stuff to show for it. So point two is that to lament is to be honest. Naming reality is the start of lament. When a doctor has to inform folks in the waiting room of a death, that doctor can't beat around the bush. He or she has to use the word die. I mean, imagine if a doctor came into the waiting room and he or she said, "Great Uncle John fell asleep. Great Uncle John is with the Lord now." I mean, like, in that situation, you're going to be like, what do you actually mean? There is a 1980s movie, The Goonies, Never Say Die. No, we actually have to say die sometimes because it's part of the lived human experience. And sometimes saying the words, talking about death or the hard things of life, it may feel taboo, but in reality, naming hard truths is important for those people who are experiencing loss or grief or trauma. That term, gaslighting, it's used to describe when someone's reality is denied by someone else, causing that person to question their own reality. Sometimes we do that when we say, oh, it wasn't that bad, or, oh, let's find the brighter side of that really terrible situation. I mean, if you're the person going through the terrible situation and you need to find the shiny side because it helps you get through it, great. But we need to be careful about rushing folks who are with us in pain, rushing them to the shiny, happy thing, because we can hold space for them. As we talked about in our Job series, the sermon I should have named, Show Up and Shut Up. Show up and shut up. Let people just grieve, because nobody else in our culture is going to do that for them. They're going to try to rush them to the shiny, the bright, the light. But as people of Christ, we can hold the value of lament to let people know that they're not crazy, that they're not alone, that because they're going through a hard time, it might mean, in fact, they're not doing something wrong, that life just stinks sometimes because we live in a broken, fallen world. Instead of doing the gaslighting thing, when we make space for lament, to be honest, we help people live an authentic life and an authentic faith. The other thing is that anxiety and the consequences of anxiety increase when we're not able to name the reality that we live in. Maybe you have experienced this in your own life in a big way or a small way. But the truth is that suppressing emotions, shoving them down, it only works for so long. And then eventually it comes out in a consequence to our physical health, explosions of anger or burnout. Now, coping with reality is a reason why psychotherapy, why therapy is effective, because acknowledging and speaking reality is a way toward healing. But we can also do this for each other in the church and in the body of Christ. In Scripture, some psalms of lament are very personal, but Psalm 80 is a communal psalm of lament. There's lots of us language that goes all throughout it, and this brings us to point three. Lament can be collective. So far, we've talked about how it can be personal in our relationships, but lament is also collective. Collective healing can happen when someone hears and recognizes their own story in the midst of a bigger story. It's not just me. I thought I was the only one, but now I'm not. It can make a huge difference. We saw in the Me Too movement that happened just a few years ago, radical amounts of stories being told of people who had been mistreated, often women, that can then lead to healing, because suddenly there's not this shadow in your past of what did I do wrong, but you know, I'm not alone. And together we can shine a light on our culture and the dark secrets so that healing can happen. When a community acknowledges truth together, the community can heal together. Living in community means caring for one another. Knowing the needs of others can then help us to recognize where maybe some of our actions have been hurting instead of helping. When we neglect to have a collective lament, we can create or uphold issues related to justice, confession, repentance. And I'll be honest, a lot of church communities have fallen into this trap and have gotten caught in sinful cycles related to racism or misogyny, abusive church systems, or more. But when we embrace collective lament, it allows us to take on the burdens. And we may want to be like, oh, that's not me. Other people may not have done that, but me, no way. I don't do any of those things. But when we do that, we miss out on the revolutionary power that collective lament has. For example, lamenting the mass casualties of COVID, or war, or opioid abuse. Maybe we're not personally responsible for those things, but we live in a gigantic world community where hard things are happening, and we can say, I'm not responsible for it, too bad for you, which, guess what, is not a very Christ-like response. Or we can say, I don't know what the answers are. I'm not even totally sure how these problems started, but I want to be the body of Christ and not rush past these negative things and these tragedies. I want us to show up together to bless our community. Humility and repentance are 100% absolutely traits that reflect the character of Christ and are reflected throughout the Old Testament as well. And that brings us to point four, that Advent is a season of intermingled lament and hope. Now, today's topic might not have been what you were thinking as a way to kick off Advent, but instead of just rushing to the pretty, happy, shiny, and bypassing the ugly and the sad, I want us to look at both sides of the coin. And praise the Lord, our Holy Bible gives us full and complete permission to do this. We read in between the end of the Old Testament and the beginning of the New Testament, right? There's this 400-year gap. People are longing for the Messiah to come. They're waiting through years of silence and oppression. There's a lament and waiting. Where is God? What is God doing? Has God forgotten us? And then we open to the New Testament, to the Gospels, and the Savior comes. But it's also just not a story of instant happiness and ease, is it? The people are looking, watching, waiting with an expectation that God is going to hear their prayers and respond. And then we get to people like Anna and Simeon, who we can read about in Luke 2. They are two unrelated elderly folks who had dedicated their lives to the Lord and waiting to meet the promised Messiah. Luke 2:25 says, there was a man in Jerusalem named Simeon. He was righteous and devout, waiting for God to comfort Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. He had been told by the Holy Spirit he would not die until he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Led by the Spirit, he came into the temple, and this is the day that little baby Jesus is brought in to the temple. So led by the Spirit, Simeon comes into the temple as Jesus' parents brought him in to do for him what the law's regulations required. Simeon took the baby in his arms and blessed God. Verse 36 picks up that there was also a prophetess called Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having been widowed after a 7-year marriage, and was now 84. She had never left the temple, but worshiped with fasting and prayer night and day. She came up at that moment, that same scene with baby Jesus in the temple, and gave thanks to God and spoke about Jesus to everyone who was waiting for the redemption of Jerusalem. We remember Anna and Simeon for their faithfulness. But imagine how hard it would have been to live that way, to live their lives waiting decades for hope, waiting for the vision that the Lord gave you to come true. And then we have Mary and Joseph, whose days looking toward marriage was not at all what they had planned. And then they have their precious newborn baby. And their newlywed days involve them fleeing for their lives. In the Christmas story, we have the Magi, the wise men, who've been watching the skies. They see finally the time has come for them to follow the star, the opportunity of a lifetime for someone in their line of study. And they follow it only to be put in this ethical crisis. Should they tell Herod Jesus's location or not? They decide not to. And by doing the right thing by Jesus, Herod launches a genocide against the baby boys of Bethlehem. Our Christmas story is filled with these tensions between lament and hope. It's a beautiful, wonderful story, but it isn't shiny and perfect. It's a mess. It's a mess of lament and hope all tangled up with each other. And it is okay for our Christmas to be a mess of lament and hope also. If you are on track for a shiny, happy Christmas, I'm so glad. We need you to do that. So those people who are more in the lament side than the hope side, they need you. They need you. And that's why the excitement of children at Christmas is such a blessing. Because even when we see maybe what our wallets or our bank accounts look like, the people who aren't coming to Christmas dinner, the conflicts that are coming up again, and we just feel brokenhearted, then we have these little people around us, maybe in our homes, but definitely here in the church, who just light us up with the joy and the hope of Christmas. And we need that. We need it all to be the body of Christ together, to uplift each other as we come into this holy season. Amen. Taking the time to lament opens us up to the possibility of hoping and trusting in the faithfulness of God, that God will be present with us, right? We sang that in a song, Emmanuel, the name of God that means God with us. The hope of being freed from sin, that all will be saved. Lament opens us up in hope to healthy and whole community with one another. And lament moves us into a hope that is built on the truth and the faithfulness of God, not a gaslighted kind of faith, not an inauthentic kind of faith, but something that is real and stays with us through the highs and the lows. So as we reflect this first Sunday of Advent, our word for today is light, just closely intermingled with hope. And we remember that Christ came to be the light of the world. And we hold closely to a God that continues to come, who continues to show up and love us in the midst of our pain, our grief, our loss, our trauma, our joys, our celebrations. And we can long for Christ to show up again, for Christ to meet our deepest needs, heal our deepest wounds. So we can sing and pray and read scripture and experience lament with confidence that God hears us, and we can have hope that he will come again, that the light of the Lord is with us. Now, we have not lit our Advent candle yet today, and that is not by accident. We're going to have some men from our men's ministry come up, if you would start to make your way up now. And I've asked them to lead us in a responsive reading around lament and light as a way to close out this message. So church, as you're able, would you rise as they lead us? They're going to have some parts that they're going to read, and then we'll also have some words on the screen for us to participate in reading as well.
We often struggle to admit anger, sadness, and despair before one another and God. Help us learn to admit.
May we lament the sins we have committed and the sins committed against us. May we lament the brokenness of the world around us and the ways we have contributed to that brokenness.
Where are you, God, in the midst of our grief? Where are you, God, in the midst of our pain? Do you hear us crying out to you? Do not be angry with us. Draw near with your steadfast love. Remind us, O God, of your faithfulness.
May we learn to be honest with ourselves, with God, and with one another, in order that we might grow to reflect the kingdom of God to the world.
We have hope that God hears our lament. We have hope that we will hear one another's lament. We will create a community of light here as long as for the kingdom of God to come. As we light the first candle, we ask the light of the world to be present here with us as we learn to be honest with God, with ourselves, and with those around us. We ask God to help us hold the honesty of our community with grace and love so that as we celebrate the birth of Christ and await the return of Christ, we might see God's kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven.
Oh, wanderer, come.
Bow our heads, pray for our tithes and offerings. Lord, we just thank you for the gifts that you give us as always, Lord. We pray in this season one that is of giving, Lord, that we would give freely to you as you call us to, Father. And that we would give knowing and trusting that you have a plan in place and that your will surpasses all human understanding, that we would lean on that and not on our own understanding, Father. So, Lord, we just thank you for this time of worship and offering. And it's to you we pray all things. In your name we pray. Amen. Let's continue to close out our service and worship.
be seated. Well, I'd like to tell you about some things that we have coming up. First is to know that today is Piggy Bank Sunday, and if you have some loose change that you would like to come up and add to our piggies, all of that will go towards Nazarene Compassionate Ministries as our denomination seeks to love on many around the globe. Tonight, Revolution Youth is back. There was a bit of a pause for Thanksgiving, but we're back. I say we. Pastor Luke is back and the gang. So if you have a student in grade 6 through 12, love for you to bring them tonight at 6 p.m. And that meets the best entrance for that is to come around to our office entrance, which is just down the hill there. And there is a doorbell there that you can ring to get let in. And they usually wrap up around 7:30 if you need to pick up your student if they're not driving. So on Wednesday is the ladies' Christmas dinner, and yeah, this is always a favorite. Everybody who is a lady, you are invited to come. So what you'll do is you'll bring $30 that night, and that's going to be all-inclusive. It's at the Olive Garden. That's just down the road. It's helpful if we know you're coming. Just so we can make sure that we have a table that is the right size. And so out in our lobby, if you are here physically with us today, we'd love for you to put your name down on the paper so we have an accurate head count. If you are watching online, you can utilize the RSVP section of our website, woodbridgenaz.com/RSVP. Next Sunday, Christmas kids gifts are due. So as you are leaving, we'd love for you to stop by the tree that's out in our main lobby here. We do still have some tags left on the tree. If you would be willing to get a gift for students of our local schools who have been nominated by their counselors, we would love for you to be a part of that. And then you bring the gift back no later than next Sunday. If you are able to wrap the gift, that is great. If you are not, that's not your thing, fear not. We have folks who will wrap those for you, but the due date for that is December 10th. The 16th is a Saturday at 6:30 p.m. There's going to be a men's Christmas potluck in the gym. So we also have a sign up out there. Again, it's just helpful to know how many folks are coming. Our men's director, Rodney, is going to provide the main course, but supplemental items are very welcome for that. The following day, December 17th, on Sunday, we're going to have our young adult Christmas lunch. Young adults will meet here in the main lobby, and then we'll go to lunch together. Also, I was thinking you can wear your ugly sweaters that day, or if you have any sort of ostentatious Christmas wear, that we should just really make that extra fun for that lunch. That evening is going to be the Revolution Youth Christmas Party. So for those who are in grades 6 through 12, that will be at the Robbins home. We're not going to just put out their address, but we do want you to come. So please connect with Pastor Luke or with Don, our youth director, so we can get you that address. And that's like Secret Santa $10 gift, right? Mm-hmm. Like you bring something and then there's the whole chaotic gift exchange thing that usually goes over very well with that age group. White, thank you. That's the name, White Elephant. Awesome. Friday, December 22nd, if you are off from work or school, we'd love for you to come for Project Friday. You enter in at the office, and then we have different projects going around the church for all ages and abilities. We have a good time working together, and then we order pizza for everybody and put on a Christmas movie. So it is always lots of fun. I know that doesn't work for everybody's schedule, but if it works for yours, we'd love to have you join us that day. And then I want to tell you about what's happening on Christmas Eve, which is a Sunday this year. In the morning, we're going to have service as normal. That's going to be our Advent week 4. So we'll do that in the morning, kind of a regular Advent service. And then we'd love for you to come back at night, 6 p.m., for our candlelight service, cookies, carols, and candles, right? Those are all three really amazing things. This is, we always advertise this to our community while guests are welcome with us each and every Sunday. We're so glad to have you here. We do put extra effort into inviting our community. And last year we had 25 first-time visitors on Christmas Eve for our candlelight service. So we'd love for you to be there, love for you to invite folks. We also could use some extra help. And so in the lobby, we do have a way to sign up. You could bring cookies. If you bring cookies, we'd love for you to bring them in the morning so that they're already here by the time the evening service starts. We're looking for some folks to help set up the cookie bar, clean it up at the end, and some folks to be greeters. We have a wonderful team of greeters, but guys, 25 first-time visitors last year. We would be so lucky as to have that happen again. So we want to be able to have folks at both doors, helping people know where to park and come in the building. So we'd love for you to include that in your Christmas tradition if you will be in town. And last but not least, we are hiring for an office manager. That job position is open. And so you can go to woodbridgenaz.com/job if that is something you'd like to learn more about or apply for. With that, I'd love to turn it over to Gary Newcomb, who will be giving our benediction today.
What a blessing to see everyone here. This church is filling up. Amen. Our benediction today comes from Numbers 6:22 through 26. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. God bless you. Thank you.